So this induction heating is a non-contact induction heating process. So it is based on the electromagnetic induction that is discovered by Michael Faraday. So it is basically very simple. So induction heating, so it is a process of heating an electrically conducting material or electrically conducting object such as metals by using electromagnetic induction through the heat generated by the metals eddy currents. So it consists of an inductor or a coil, so that is fed from a high frequency supply. It consists of a coil or inductor, so that is fed from a high frequency supply. So that will produce a rapidly changing alternating magnetic flux, right? So that will penetrate through this object, so that is being heated. And it will generate electric currents inside these conductors, and these currents are known as these eddy currents. So these eddy currents flowing through this through the resistance of the material, and it will generate the heat by using this Joule heating. So that is the principle. So in this diagram, you can see that. So this is the coil. So this is fed from a high frequency AC supply, and it will produce a magnetic field. So that magnetic field will induce eddy currents inside this metal piece or this work piece. Due to these eddy currents, so this will be heated up. So that means it produces a localized heat inside this heating element. Same thing, if you are using this induction heating for the cooking applications, for example, right? So in case of heating applications like a solenoid or some solid bars, so this is the configuration. If you have some induction cooking applications, so this is the cooktop. So inside that cooktop, so we have this coil, so which is fed from a high frequency supply. Okay, so this will produce a magnetic field. So that magnetic field will induce eddy currents in this cooktop or in this pan or in this cooking utensil. So usually we prefer flat bottom cooking utensils to so that the uniform heat can be produced. We'll discuss more on this. So this is induction heating. This is the workpiece or the metals that being that require to heat it up, and this is the inductor. This is the coil. So where with this inductor is fed from a high frequency supply. So there are two phenomena, or the two mechanisms of this energy dissipation in case of this induction heating. So one is the energy losses due to the Joule effect. So when we are applying an alternating voltage to an inductor coil, induction coil, so an alternating current is generated in the coil, right? So the current produces an alternating magnetic field. So it will produce an alternating magnetic field. So what is that law? So that is Ampere's law, right? And that induces the voltage in the workpiece, so which opposes to the variation of the magnetic field. So by using the Lenz law, okay, so these voltages creates the current in the workpiece. So this called as is. Hello, what happened? What happened? I'm audible.
Yes, sir. No problem. Okay.
So what we are discussing. So there are so for this induction heating, so there are two mechanisms. So one is the energy loss due to the Joule effect. So when applying an alternating voltage to an induction coil, okay, so an alternating current is generated in the coil. So this current produced in this coil produces an alternating magnetic field by using Ampere's law, and that will induce a voltage in the workpiece, so which opposes to this variation of this magnetic field. So by using this Lenz law, so these voltages create the current in the workpiece. This is called as the eddy currents, so which have the same frequency but opposite direction than the original current, right? So these eddy current produces the heat by using this Joule effect. Okay, we have this Joule effect, right? What is the Joule effect? P is proportional to I square into R. So this is the Joule heating. So not only this eddy currents, so we have also this hysteresis currents that also produces, right? So why these hysteresis currents are produced? You have, when you have this magnetic dipoles, so when you have this ferromagnetic materials are magnetized in one direction and other direction, so these appears to be, so generally these are appears below this Curie temperature, right? You know this Curie temperature. What is Curie temperature? What is the Curie temperature? The frequent magnetization and this non-magnetization, so the loops, we have some power losses, right? Or some heat losses. Those are known as hysteresis losses. So this Curie temperature is the temperature at which the material becomes non-magnetic. So generally this hysteresis currents also that produces inside this workpiece. So, but usually this hysteresis losses that only represent typically 7%, so when compared to this eddy currents. So therefore we generally neglect this effect or this hysteresis effect. So the only we will consider the eddy currents. So this induction heating, right? So we have some things we have to do is, so the first thing is we need to model this this entire setup, that is the inductor and workpiece modeling. Okay, this workpiece and this inductor, these two things we need to model. So there are two models that are available. So one is the series model and this parallel model. So that is the first thing. So that is modeling of this inductor and this workpiece. And the second one is, so how much power, right? So this is essentially we require a high frequency supply. So that high frequency supply is obtained from a inverter circuit, right? So here, so we need to estimate, or we need to design estimate the power required from the converter. We need to estimate the power required from the converter. So that is the other thing. And the third one is, so how much frequency we need to operate. That is the selection of frequency. So one is the modeling of this heating element. Second one is the selection of power rating. And the third one is the selection of frequency. So these three things are important in designing this induction heating or induction heater. So we have different types of models are there. So one is the series model and this parallel model. So generally this series model is preferred when compared to this parallel model. So why in series model the current is same? So therefore the calculations becomes easy. This entire thing we will model as some R equivalent. So that is a series equivalent and inductors L and inductance L. So generally this induction coil, the workpiece is electrically modeled by using an inductor and its equivalent resistance, this R equivalent, it may be in series or parallel. So when you are considering this equivalent resistance, okay, so we need to consider the resistor or the resistance of this workpiece, so that is reflected in the coil, and as well as the inductor resistance. Okay, so this equivalent resistance, so that is the effective resistance of this workpiece and as well as the inductance, the resistance of this inductor. Okay, it consists of two terms. One is the effective resistance of this this workpiece and the inductor. So this is the coil inductance. This one is the L is the coil inductance. The next thing is, so how to determine this R equivalent in case of this parallel model. So it's everything is same, just we are parallel model this R equivalent and this L. So generally this parallel model is less preferred. So next thing is, so how to determine this equivalent resistance, this R equivalent. So this equivalent resistance is the main resistor, so that will dissipate the heat by using this eddy currents in the workpiece. Okay. So it represents the power dissipated in the workpiece. This actually represents the power dissipated in the workpiece. Okay. So taking into these considerations, so this can be defined as this R equivalent. So this RS into KR S heated. Is NC square by LW square. So this is for a long bars, solid long bar like this. Okay. So here this RS, so it is the superficial resistance of this workpiece. It is a superficial, so resistance of this workpiece. So that is defined as rho W by this delta W. So this rho W is the electrical resistivity of this workpiece. So rho W is the electrical resistivity of the workpiece, and this is the resistivity. And this one is the penetration depth. So we'll discuss about this penetration depth. And this KR, so it's a dimensionless. So actually it takes into the account of the variation of the electrical paths between the equivalent diameter of the piece and the penetration depth. So this is equal to this KR, so which is equal to, so 1 minus e to the power of minus 2 R W minus 2 R W by delta W. So here this R W is the radius of this workpiece, So this KR is the important factor. So when fixing the frequency, this KR is the important factor. So when fixing the frequency, so this has heated. So that is surface to be heated. So S heated is a surface that is to be heated. So it is usually simplified, so by using the perimeter of this piece, so that multiply, so by its own length. So perimeter multiply its own length, so that gives you the surface. Okay. So this LW, it is the length of workpiece. LW is the length of workpiece. Right. And this NC is the number of turns in the inductor coil. NC is the number of turns in the inductor coil. So this R equivalent is the effective resistance of this entire setup, so that which is essentially caused for the heat inside the, or essentially used for generating the heat, right? So this is for a long bars. In case of induction heating, where we are using for cooking applications, so like this. So in case of this arrangement, where you have the circular arrangement, so the formula will be R equivalent. So this KR NC square rho W 2 pi RW by delta W into LW. So So everything is remains same. This KR, this NCM, this rho W, LW, everything is same. So only thing, this RW is the radius of workpiece. So this RW is the radius of this workpiece. Okay. So this is for long bars, and whereas this one is for circular bars or the circular things. That is solid round bar, so solid round things. Clear? So this is the effective resistance. So we have also the formulas for this L. So I will write here the formula for inductance. Right. So here the calculating the inductance is very difficult thing. Okay. So you require some mathematical modeling or some numerical analysis is required to calculate the effective inductance or effective inductance. Okay. Or else we have to use this inductance measurement meters to actually measure the inductance. So this inductance is actually vary from the size, number of turns, and the material that is used, right? So therefore, we have some formula for in case of solid bars. So this is 10 pi mu naught NC square RC square into 9RC plus 10 into LC. So this is the formula in case of solenoid kind of things. So this is Wheeler's formula. To calculate the inductance. So here this L is the inductance value. So this L is the inductance value. So this LC is the length of the coil. LC is the length of the coil. RC is the radius. RC is the radius of the coil. Or this LC is the length. This RC is the radius. And this mu naught is the magnetic permeability of the vacuum. Mu naught is the magnetic permeability of the vacuum, so which is equal to 4 pi into 10 to the power of minus 7. Okay. And mu is mu r into mu naught, and this mu r is the so relative magnetic permeability, right? So this is relative magnetic permeability. So this is about the selection of, or this about the calculation of this R equivalent and this L. So we have another thing, so which is important. So that is the penetration depth. Okay. So that is the penetration depth. So this penetration depth, so you might have studied the skin effect on the conductors, right? You have studied the skin effect on the conductors. So based on that, so we have this penetration depth. So that means the current density is varying from the surface to that, and we are going inside the material. So if you consider the currents that are induced in this workpiece, right? So that will induce some magnetic field. So that will oppose this original magnetic field. So that means we have this induced magnetic field. So in this, so that will oppose the original magnitude, a magnetic field. So that is produced by the inductor. So these magnetic fields cancel each other. Okay, these magnetic fields cancel each other, and the resultant magnetic field it will becomes weak, right? So therefore, this induced currents in this are actually concentrated at the surface, and it will be reduced exponentially. So when it is reaching the center, okay. So that means most of the current is confined to the surface, and it will be reduced when it's going inside this surface, so like this. Okay, so here this current density waveforms, so this is the current density. So at the surface it will be very high, right? So as and when, so we are going inside that, so this current density is reducing exponentially. So that means at the center we can expect that there is no current flow. So here also, this is the other surface, so where this current density is high, and it is reducing here. So this is known as, so how to define this penetration depth? So this is the surface from the distance from the surface. So here this we have zero, so that is on the surface. So when you're going, this is the current density on the y-axis. Okay, the current density on the y-axis. So where we have this current density is reduced to this original value, this JS value. So where it is reduced to 0.368 times, this, that is 1 by E times, 1 by E times. So that gives you the this penetration depth here. So where it is reduced by 1 by E times. The current density is reduced by a depth of 1 by E times. So the depth is known as this penetration depth. So this is defined like this. So delta is so rho pi mu into F. So this is also known as this rho is 2 rho mu into this omega, or else this 503 commonly used formula, this rho into omega this mu r into F. Okay, so up to this point it is 1 by E. So when you are calculating the power, you might have studied that it is 86% of the power, so that is B. So there at this point, so up to here, so 86% of the power, so that is available. So rest of the period, so remaining 14% of the power, so that is here. So here this F is the frequency of the current. F is the frequency of the current. So this rho is the resistivity of the material. So this rho is the resistivity of the material. So if you notice that, so this penetration depth, this is depends on the frequency. These values are almost constant. So most of the cases. So that means this rho is, or this this delta is proportional to, so 1 by square root F. So that is the frequency. So when you have this high penetration depth, so when you have this high penetration depth, so that is for, so when it is happening, so if the frequency is low, if the frequency is low, the penetration depth will be high. Okay, so therefore this eddy currents of this opposite sign, it may be cancelled each other. The eddy currents with this opposite sign, it may be cancelled each other. So under this case, what will happen, that the heat in this workpiece, this workpiece is decreases, the heat will be decreases, and so the efficiency will be reduces. Okay, so this F is very low. So in that case, the penetration depth will be high. So therefore, what will happen with the penetration depth? The heat will be reduces. So therefore, so we need to define, or we need to select this frequency such that, so we have some optimum efficiency. So now how to select the frequency, we'll discuss now. So we have defined a formula here. So this R equivalent, so this is basically the main thing. So that is causes the heat, right? So if you have the more value of this R equivalent, so the heat will be more, okay? If you have this more value of this R equivalent, so the heat generated will also be high. So generally, so this RS will be, so this is usually fixed one. This the heat, the surface of this is also fixed one. So whereas this number of coil and this length of this one is usually fixed. So this means this R equivalent, so which is proportional to this KR. This R equivalent is proportional to this KR. So what is this KR? So we already discussed this, right? It's a dimensional factor. So this case, it is taken into the consideration of this variation of this electrical depth, or this electrical path between this equivalent diameter of the piece and this penetration depth. So this R equivalent, so which is proportional to this this factor KR, this factor KR, right? So this KR is defined like this: 1 minus E into E to the power of 2 into R omega, so R W into, so delta W. So that means it depends on this. So this RW is fixed, so therefore KR is depends on this penetration depth. This KR depends on this penetration depth. So if you are increasing this frequency, for example, the penetration depth, so that is reduces. The penetration depth reduces. So why it is reduces? For example, if you are increasing this frequency, that the penetration depth decreases. So when this penetration depth decreases, so what will happen? This KR value will be high, right? Or this KR will be, this is in this side, right? So if you are reducing this one, so therefore this KR will be high. So when this KR value will be high, so under this case, this R equivalent will be high. Okay. So if you have high frequency, so under this case, the penetration depth will be reduced. The penetration depth is reduced. So when the penetration depth reduced, this KR value will be increased. So when this KR increased, the equivalent resistance R equivalent, see it, that is increased. So therefore, the effective power, that is the power generated in the workpiece for a given current, will be increased. Right. So for example, what will happen if this this frequency becomes infinite? If the frequency becomes infinite, so what will happen? For example, if the frequency is infinite, if frequency is infinite, so what is the value of penetration depth?
Zero.
Zero, right? So if it is zero, so what is the value of KR?
One.
So KR is one, right? Okay, so that means you can obtain, so if the penetration depth or the frequency is infinite, if it is tend to infinite, so this delta, this one is become zero. So therefore this KR, that is equal to one, right? That is equal to one. So therefore we have this maximum, the maximum value of this KR is one, right? So therefore we have this maximum R equivalent resistance, or this resistance of the workpiece. So therefore it will produce maximum power. It will produce maximum power. Similarly, if this frequency is very low, if the frequency is very low, so what will happen? The penetration depth will be increased. The penetration, so depth will be increased. So therefore this KR, it will be reduced. So that will reduce this R equivalent. So therefore the power supplied, it will be reduced. Okay. So we cannot operate at infinite frequency to obtain the maximum power. Okay. If you are operating at infinite frequency, or what will happen? You cannot practically get that, right? We cannot operate that. So therefore we need to optimally choose the frequency. We need to optimally choose the frequency. So when you have this higher value of frequencies, when you're operating with a higher value, so what will happen? Non-uniform heat distribution will happen. Okay, non-uniform heat distribution will happen when you have higher frequencies. But when you are operating at a lower frequency, the power will be less. Okay, the power in the workpiece will be less, or the heat generated in the workpiece. When the power is less, also automatically the heat will be less. So therefore we need to have some frequency, that is critical frequency, we need to select. So where we have this optimum things. So generally, as a rule of thumb, this critical frequency is selected as, right? This critical frequency, see, it is selected as one by, right? For a critical, means how this critical frequency is selected. So that based on the this penetration depth, if the workpiece diameter means if the, okay, based on the means, for example, So workpiece is having some thickness of 1 millimeter, for example. Okay. So we have, for example, we have something like 0.2, means we have this penetration depth such that, so it is 0.25 millimeter. If the penetration depth is 0.2, such that we have this penetration depth of 0.mm. So based on that, this frequency will be selected. Okay. So for example, that means 1/4 times the penetration depth. So we need to select based on that, we need to select the frequency. So this formula is like this, right? So what is the formula? So this is 2 rho. So mu, this omega, right? So this inside this, we have this frequency term. So that is 503 times this rho into mu r into f. Okay. So this f value be selected such that if you know the thickness of the workpiece, right, if you know the thickness of this workpiece, so we need to select this f value such that this will be, this penetration depth will be 1/4 times the thickness of workpiece. Okay, clear? We need to select the frequency such that the penetration depth will be 1/4 times the thickness of workpiece. Okay, so this is just a rule of thumb, so there is no formula, so that is involved here actually. Okay, so generally at 1/4 of the thickness, or 1/4 of this thickness of this, the penetration depth is 1/4 of the thickness, so then the efficiency, or the efficiency will be maximum, and the power generated, so that is also high. So this is how we will select the frequency. So generally, if you have low frequency, the heat that generated will be high. If you have high frequency, so to generate high frequency, the losses will be high. So apart from that, if you have excess frequency, what will happen? The heat distribution will not be uniform. The heat distribution inside that workpiece will not be uniform. So we need to carefully select this frequency. So what else we have? Yeah. So next one is the power requirement. The power requirement. So how much means how to fix the converter power? How to fix the power electronics? So converter power. Okay. So let us assume that this PW. So let us assume that, so this PW is the power needed to heat a workpiece from a given temperature, from given initial temperature to some final temperature. So this PW is the power needed to heat a workpiece for a given temperature. So this PW, so this is, we have this MC, this is defined as MC into, so this T final minus this T initial by time T. So this is the final temperature that we required. So this is the average value of this final temperature, so that we required, and this is the initial temperature of the workpiece. So where this M is the mass of the workpiece, it is the mass of the workpiece, and the C is specific heat of the material. So this is the average specific heat of the material. So this is the specific heat of material, and this is the time T, is the time that required, or the time that required to heat the material, the time that required to heat the material. Clear? So this is the power, this is the mechanical, or this is thermal power that required, this PW. We have this MC into T final minus T initial by the time T. So where M is the mass of the workpiece, C is the specific heat of the element, or the workpiece element. So T is the required temperature, T initial is the initial temperature, and the T is the the time duration you required. Okay, so obviously if you have less time, if the less time you required, so you need to inject or you need to have some more amount of power. If the mass is high, so you require more power. If the specific heat is high, more power is required. And if you want to heat it for higher temperatures, so you require more power. Right. So this PW or this power, it must be obtained from the power converter, right? It must be obtained from the power converter. So this is the thermal power. How to select this electrical power? So how to select the electrical power, or in case of this power converter? So this is the rating of power converter. So this is the rating of power converter. So this is right. So we have two different type of losses, right? So one is the losses, thermal losses we need to include, and we also include the electrical losses. Right. So this PC, right. So this PW into efficiency into, this is thermal efficiency. Or this efficiency. So this one is defined like this: efficiency of thermal into efficiency of electrical. So this is the total efficiency. So this is efficiency of thermal and this efficiency of electrical. So multiply together. It's clear. So this will give you the rating of power converter. So next step is how to calculate the efficiency of thermal. So this is PW, that is the power on the workpiece. Actually, I borrowed all these from mechanical department. So this PW plus this P, thermal losses. Okay. So this P thermal losses, this is efficiency, right? This PW into PW plus P thermal losses. And where is this thermal losses? So this can be defined like this. So this is 3.74. Okay, we have some formula is there. So this LC into log. So DC by DW. DC by DW. So this one is the thermal losses through the surface, and this DC and DW are the inside coil diameter and this workpiece diameter. So this DC and DW are the inside diameters of coil and workpiece. Inside diameters of this coil and workpiece. So this LC is the length of the coil. So this LC is the length of coil. So that gives you the thermal efficiency. That gives you this thermal efficiency. So these are whatever the formula that we are discussing is the first approximations. Okay, so some approximations we have. So in case of electrical efficiency, in case of electrical efficiency, so it will be 1 by 1 plus DC plus delta C DW minus delta W. Rho C mu R into this rho W. This delta C and this delta W are the penetration depths of These are the penetration depths of this coil and workpiece. And this rho C and this rho W, okay, are the electrical resistivity of this coil and workpiece. This mu r is the relative permeability of workpiece. Okay. So we have formula for this thermal efficiency and we have this electrical efficiency. So as to calculate the actual rating or the required rating of the power converter. Okay. So no need to remember all these things, just to understand. So how actually in practice, how they are actually, see in your, when you're buying some induction cooking, all right, they mentioned that this is 2000 watts, right? Or something like that, right? 2000 watt or 1000 watt. So how that actual turn, so it is there. So that what we are discussing now. Okay. So generally the efficiency of this induction heating, it's very high. If you're looking to its applications, so this is used in cooking applications. Okay, this induction heaters or this heating is used in cooking applications. We have this induction heating. So generally we prefer a flat bottom pans. The flat bottom pans are preferred so as to means the heat transfer means the heat will be the efficiency will be high. So generally we use a ferrous materials. Okay, we use ferrous materials as a utensil, like this iron and some metals. So generally we avoid this this copper bottom. We have this copper bottom utensils will be there, right? So generally they're not the preferred choice. This copper bottom or this aluminum utensils are not the preferred choice for this induction heating. So generally we prefer this iron utensils or the flat iron utensils. So generally this top will be, so there is no heat on this top. So when you are using it for this cooking applications, so what we have, this temperature can be precisely controlled. The temperature is precisely controlled so that when you're frying or something, right, we have we can, means it will not overcook. So the other application is melting of metals. If you want to melt a particular metal, so we need to place it on this induction coil, right? So a localized, and another important thing is that the heating will be localized. So that means we can have the specific heating, a particular area is heated or the local heating is generated. So surface hardening to use to means surface will be hardening, means to harden the surface. So this annealing, okay, this annealing, so if you want to stretch the some metals, all right, so in that case this this is suitable. And forging, you know, this forging, right, to produce some hard materials or some materials like hammers and other, right, so they will heat it and so apply some force on it so that this this will become harder. So the main advantage, so with this induction heating is, so the cleanliness, so it will not produce any smoke, ash or any dirts. So it is safety, so there is no open flames, so there is no risk of a fuel leakage. So controllability, so heating can be regulated precisely. You can actually regulate the heating in some temperature with a regulation of 0.5 degrees centigrade. Higher efficiency, the efficiencies will be high when compared to this gas-fired or this coal-fired things. So this automatic steering, in some applications we have this automatic steering where we are, the currents are moving, therefore the workpiece also, so the steering is happening. Okay, so there are some limitations for this induction heating. So one is this non-sinusoidal current drawn from the supply, so it will produce some non-sinusoidal currents. Okay, so we'll discuss this, so how to overcome this problem. And it will inject harmonics into the power lines. Okay, so both are same. It will inject harmonic in the power lines. So when you have this harmonics, we have this failure of this protection devices. So it will interfere with communication lines and some audible noise from this transformer. Okay, so these will are normally this induction are operated at a frequency of 100 kilohertz or 50 to 200 kilohertz range. So therefore we can expect some electromagnetic interference with this communication lines. So it is low power factor, so due to inductive load. So this is basically an inductive load. The resistance is small, so when compared to its inductance, so that means there is a low power factor. So however, this whatever this disadvantage there, so that are overcome, so with this modern power electronics. The another thing is so we can actually increase the efficiency by using this Rozhnev concept. We can actually increase its efficiency. Okay. So this is about the introduction to the induction heating and how to select the frequency, how to select or how to estimate the resistance of the workpiece, inductance, and how much amount of, how to select the power ratings of the power converters. Okay, so next class we'll discuss about the modeling of the series elements or this parallel elements, and after that we'll discuss about the power converters, so that are used in this induction heating process. Okay, you have any questions? Questions? Okay, we'll stop here.